Hello and welcome, everyone. My name is Markus Bauer, and as the slide suggests, I'm working for the Fraunhofer Institute for Cell Therapy and Immunology in Leipzig, where I'm part of a unit that focuses on cell functional image analysis. While most of our work covers typical microscopy tasks, we also have started working with artificial intelligence for analyzing histopathological images in a few of our projects lately. In one of these projects, which is also part of my master thesis, we are using deep convolutional neural networks for the grading of prostate cancer image samples. In the next few minutes, I will give you a little insight about how good those networks are suited for this task in my talk called Neural Network for Analyzing Prostate Cancer Tissue Microarrays, a Report on Problems and Possibilities. So, first of all, let's have a little introduction to the topic. Our work is inspired by the Gleason grading system, which is the international standard measure for pathological ratings of prostate carcinoma tissue samples. Our key perspective is to categorize whether and where the samples contain benign or malignant tissue. Additionally, for malignant areas, we want to distinguish between so-called high-grade and low-grade tumors. The Gleason grading is based on morphological similarities that can typically be observed for an associated aggressiveness of a carcinoma. A vague idea of those structures is depicted in figure 1. What the Gleason grading pays most attention to is the shape of the glands, which de-differentiate the more the prostate gets infiltrated by a tumor. The good thing about this approach is that this grading system initially enabled doctors to make a better prognosis about an individual patient's risk. Besides that, by using the Gleason grading, any pathologist has kind of the same scale to judge a case, and therefore findings can be compared. But the system obviously has a subjective aspect, which makes it biased and therefore makes it prone to always keep a degree of uncertainty. This uncertainty results in an intra-observer reproducibility of 87% at best. That means that even a grading of an expert pathologist with years of experience may not be reproducible by another pathologist with the same expertise or even himself. For the patient, this of course increases the risk of not getting the best suited therapy, as well as it increases the risk to suffer from negative post-operative after effects. But as the Gleason already is based on morphological structures, computational image analysis seems to be a good bet, and therefore we asked ourselves the question, can we do an automatic mining of morphological patterns and algorithmically learn to distinguish grades of malignancy from those? To solve this question, we used a neural network architecture. Basically, a neural network is a mathematical model that resembles human learning behavior, inspired by neurons in biological sense. A special form of it is a convolutional neural network, as depicted in figure 2. So basically, an image serves as the input of the network, and by passing the image through this network, it will be transformed to a category, which is called a class. In the past years, impressive results could be achieved, for example, in analyzing breast cancer or basal cell carcinoma images. Thus, we concluded that this approach seems to be promising for our problem as well. For training and testing our network, we use so-called tissue microarrays. Those contain a grid of tissue samples, which is digitalized by a slide scanner. In our case, the nominal squared pixel resolution of the scans was around 230 nanometers per pixel. Such a tissue microarray can be seen in figure 4. The data used in our study is supplied by the University Hospital Bonn. In total, we used 19 arrays, which sums up to a cohort of 303 patients. The samples themselves are taken from radical prostatectomy, so after the prostate has been removed completely. After resection, the prostate is fixed with paraffin, colored, and samples get extracted using a cannula of up to 1 mm in diameter. For each patient, our dataset contained 2 samples of carcinoma and 1 sample of benign tissue. Each sample looks similar to figure 3. Typically, we can find 3 main components, which are stroma, which is colored in pink or red, cytoplasm, which is colored in a lighter pink or lighter red tone, nuclei, which are colored in purple or blue and encircled by cytoplasm and nuclei, the lumen, which are transparent. The structures that matter most here are the arrangements of nuclei and cytoplasm around the white lumen parts, which are the glands. Sadly, feeding those tissue microarray images directly to a neural network is not feasible, as first of all, the images have way too big extents and also show significant differences in staining. As directly feeding the images is no option, we created a pre-processing toolchain. The problems that we wanted to tackle with this were the large scale of the images, the staining differences, the remaining background in the images, and the very low amount of them, even after splitting them up into smaller patches. So for that purpose, first of all, we crop squares that only contain non-background areas from each image contained in a tissue microarray. From each cropped image, we then created a grid of 5x5 patches, generating an amount of roughly 20,000 patches in total. We then applied a stain normalization, as it can be seen on the right hand of figure 5. For each input, a reference image associated with the same Gleason score has been selected at random from a set of available references. Additionally, we applied data augmentation techniques such as zooming, stretching, and flipping when training our network, as those are known to improve the network's accuracy on small datasets as ours. After the pre-processing, data could finally be used for training the actual model. As we created patches from the tissue samples, we only could assume one Gleason score per tissue sample, as no further information was available. Therefore, instead of the Gleason score, we selected a primary grade, as it is the most frequent one and there is a good chance of a single patch matching it. Considering figure 7, we can see that the distribution of available grades is very imbalanced. This is a natural result of the fact that lower grades tend to not even be spotted, and higher grades often aren't found due to active screening and a resection before further progression of the carcinoma. As a consequence of this imbalance, we needed to clip the maximum amount of images per class, so our network will not overfit one of them when training. We selected a maximum of around 1,800 samples per class for the training and 200 samples per class for the test set. Using this dataset, we trained a mobile net, which is originally considered for the usage in mobile applications. The advantage to deeper architectures, such as Google's Inception Net, is that on one hand, the mobile net has dedicated layers per color channel, which can be extremely useful, especially because most important information is transported by the blue nuclei in our case, and besides that, its depth is scalable by a parameter alpha that we set to 0.75, helping one to suppress overfitting effects. In addition, weights of a pre-trained network, taken from referencing work as cited in the slides, could be used using this architecture. To get a baseline accuracy, we used the pre-trained mobile net to create predictions for our data. The accuracy was found to be 48% on a test dataset, which was relatively low in comparison to 75% achieved in the referring paper. In general, a high confusion between neighboring grades as well as confusion to all grades for grade 5 could be found, as can be seen in figure 8. Note that for this confusion matrix, as well as for the following ones, 0 denotes benign and 1 to 3 denote Gleason grades 3 to 5. The high drop in accuracy suggests that the network is poorly generalized. A possible reason for that lies in the staining differences, especially because the mobile net pays particular attention to the red, green, and blue channel of the patches. To further investigate this assumption, we normalized each patch to a fixed reference patch of the same Gleason grade, taken from the dataset used in the reference paper. After that, we trained our network for a further 50 epochs with a batch size of 16. As initial weights had already been supplied, we only trained the final fully connected layer, performing a so-called transfer learning. That way, convergence behavior could already be observed after 10 epochs. Using this approach, an accuracy of 95% could be achieved for the test dataset. Looking at figure 9, we can see that the least successful prediction was 84% for Gleason grade 3, while Gleason grade 4 seems to be matched perfectly. This result seemed to be very promising, but however a little over-optimistic. While the separation from benign to carcinoma tissue seems more plausible, the clear separation of the Gleason grades is too good to be true for multiple reasons. First of all, labels have been set for the whole sample instead of the created patches. Hence, a little bit of confusion is expected, as not every patch is labeled correctly. The effect should amplify as we selected the primary grade, and there should be patches containing the secondary grade as well. In addition, there is still noise caused by the remaining uncertainty of the pathologist's rating itself. Under these circumstances, a plausible confusion matrix necessarily would include remaining false positives between neighboring grades, which it doesn't. The effect we observe here is a simple fitting to the staining that shows significant differences between the reference patches and therefore between patches used for training and testing too. This shows how important staining can be in this context. It is very probable that due to the clear difference in staining, the network simply memorizes the color characteristics of, example given, stromatic regions in total, but ignores the morphologies. It can then make a prediction which seems to have a high confidence, but in fact misses the goal we want to achieve. So, in order to overcome this problem, we changed our final setup according to the conclusions we made from the initial training procedures. A thing to mention at this point is that training the network from scratch resulted in long training durations and also showed that the network tends to overfit. In addition, simply training the network without any staining normalization decreased accuracy significantly. In our final experiment, we applied normalization to a random reference picked from a set of patches with the same Gleason grade as the target. We also separated the reference patches for training and test set. That way, a trade-off between unifying the stain and making the images more comparable has been done. We then again trained our network for 50 epochs with 16 batches and a learning rate of 0.001. The accuracy achieved on the test set settled between the results of the prior experiments at 68%. Looking at the referring confusion matrix in figure 10, we find similar patterns to those in figure 8, but with slight improvements. We can spot most confusion between neighboring grades, while Gleason grade 5 seems to be better distinguishable now. The best accuracy was captured for Gleason grade 4 with 66%. For all the other classes, accuracy lies around 55%. We also controlled those results by creating various independent training and test folds using the stratified k-fold method and repeated the training for each of those. Accuracy could be found to lie between 58 and 68%, with per-class confusion similar to the one you can see in figure 10. This result supports the conclusions of related work on that topic and seems plausible, especially as confusion occurs where we would expect it. Summarizing, one could say that an accuracy of 68% at best is still very low, but there is limitations that should be considered. Besides analyzing the captured accuracy, we also checked whether the network really pays attention to the regions that we would consider as relevant. That is, all the parts in the image that contain gland walls, or at least larger compounds of nuclei when glands are strongly dedifferentiated. For that purpose, we used class activation maps, of which an example can be found in figure 11. The yellow regions mark all the pixels with an activation height higher than a manually set threshold. Note that the background is marked as well, as all white patches have never been shown to the network and create an uncalculatable behavior. As a result, their activations are not excluded in the applied thresholding. As those are regularly discarded anyways, this is however no problem. Figure 11 shows that stromatic regions, as expected, seem to have almost no relevance to the network, while larger part of the gland walls have. This confirms the intuition and makes the prediction seem plausible. In another grad cam, captured after a training without normalization, which is not shown here, activated regions included a remarkable amount of stromatic tissue, so all in all, the final training procedure seems to be suitable. Summarizing, what have we learned from using artificial intelligence in this context? We've learned that in conclusion this approach seems to be absolutely promising. The biggest advantage clearly lies in the fact that a large cohort of patients can be used for automatic feature extraction, which offers the possibility to find common morphologies among similar cases. We've also learned that this is still not as easy as for many other applications of neural networks. First of all, staining has a large influence that needs to be considered and compensated. The procedure we used here also may not be the best option, as it depends on setting a reference and therefore comes in with a lot of limitations. So, for that purpose, a new approach is required. Second of all, the small size of the dataset is an inherent challenge. Typically, when we are talking about neural network datasets, we are talking about 10,000s, 100,000s, or millions of images that are considered. For our approach, even if we ignored the imbalance, only 20,000 images were available. This can be compensated a little bit by using a transfer learning, but in general, a larger amount of samples would be necessary. Last but not least, a real-world network needs to generalize better. As it has been quite a while since the results I presented have been generated, it's self-explaining that we proceeded and tried to work out solutions for the problems mentioned. First of all, we created a better normalization approach based on a clustering of the image's color spaces. As shown in figure 12a and b, we separate stroma, nuclei, mucin, lumen and cytoplasm and use unified colors for each of them. That way each image has an identical stain which does no longer depend on its preparation. Additionally, we picked data from the Cancer Genome Atlas as a base for training our model, and instead of taking every patch into account, we excluded stromatic ones by a further pre-processing step to initially distinguish between relevant and non-relevant image regions and make the network focus even more on the glands. With these updates applied, we achieve a better tumor versus non-tumor classification while increasing test set accuracy to 70%. The accuracy was also found to be in a smaller range of 65 to 70% when compared for multiple folds. As figure 13 suggests, 3 out of 5 classes perform quite well. The remaining error, however, still relates to uncertainty in labeling, which we currently try to solve with unsupervised learning approaches. So, that's it from my side. At this point, I want to kindly acknowledge Glenn Christiansen from the University Hospital Bonn, who supplied us with the data we used and also gave us necessary background information whenever needed. I also want to say special thanks to Ulf Dietrich Braumann, Sebastian Zürner and Georg Popp, which are my colleagues at the Fraunhofer Institute. Last but not least, I want to acknowledge Irini Avaniti, whose network rates and dataset have been used in particular, as she kindly made those accessible for public use. Thank you for your attention.